Okay, so how is everyone today?
Good.
Good? Need a break from the break. Need a break to recover from the break. need a break to recover from Pi Day.
Oh yeah, super crazy.
Okay. So, last time for lecture, we did Newton's method, and we talked about square roots. And then the programming assignment was computing square root with Newton's method. And another one was, so notably, when you compute square roots with Newton's method, you never use the square root function of the machine, of the programming language. So it's sort of like, how would you compute a square root using only your wits and arithmetic? Okay, in the fastest way possible. Another one of the exercises, let's see, today's the 21st, huh? Yeah.
Great.
It's the day after the equinox. Okay. The second assignment from last time was how to perform division, but without using division. Kind of interesting question. So that sort of answers for you, how does the machine divide? You know, if you're at the MATLAB prompt, you can type, for example, the division of any two numbers that you like 5 divided by pi, and MATLAB will spit out some number. Right? So then the question sort of is, well, how does MATLAB do it? How does it compute? You can remember doing that in grade school, the long division algorithm. Okay. Well, MATLAB does more or less exactly what that programming assignment was. It first takes the numerator and the denominator, and it performs a few manipulations upon them, and then computes the reciprocal, and then computes a product. And it does it entirely without division. And it does that all in circuitry that's in the machine. And it does it quite rapidly. Very neat. So any question about the division problem? Any question about it? It was okay? Okay, so I'll just make a few brief remarks about it, since we didn't really talk about it in lecture yet. So this is the floating point. Division. That is to say, you want to compute, for example, if you wanted to compute 2 divided by 3, the answer would be 0.66666666, as many sixes as the machine can write down, and then eventually it'll write 7, right? Because it rounds that last one. Okay, so we want to be able to compute division, and this is the way the machine does it. So in the first place, if you look at the function f of x is 1 over x. So this function is called the reciprocal function. And if we plot just the top right part of this function, and the reciprocal function looks like this. More or less. Of course, this is y is f of x, y is 1 over x for x greater than 0. The other part's down there. So now, if we mark out some points on the plot, so say 1, 2, 3. If this is 1, and this is 2, and 3, then half is about right here.
And so now we're going to take the points
half and 1. Just the 2 points, half and 1. So these two right here.
And now we're going to sort of cut out just that piece of the reciprocal function.
So what is this y value right here?
1.
1, right. And what is this y value right here?
2.
2.
So we cut out just that piece of the reciprocal function.
So now I'm going to take a good look at it and zoom in, right? It's my artist's impression of an eyeball. Okay. So we're going to zoom in on it, and it'll look like something like the following. Of course, this is going to be very exaggerated. So it hits the top left and it hits the bottom right, and then it bends like so.
So that's the piece of the reciprocal function that we're looking at. And what we want to do, one of the first things that we're going to do,
so half to 1.
Is what we want to do is be able to approximate this function. Okay. We want to approximate it. And we're going to approximate it using the same Newton's method as before. Now, the way Newton's method works is that you have an initial guess, and then you start iterating, and that gets you closer and closer. And when you're using Newton's method, it's very wise to have as good of a guess as you possibly can. Okay? As good of an initial guess as you possibly can. So, on that exercise, I told you how to make the best possible guess. It was with those coefficients that I can't recall because they're not very important. But in the end, notice that this red is not straight. It's not a straight line. But you can imagine that we could sort of try and find the best line that approximates it. So, for example, you know, taking this line, that wouldn't be a very good approximation. It is a line, but it's not a very good one. So you can imagine, well, no, don't go higher, go lower. Okay, somewhere in the middle there, and then maybe turn it a little bit. Turn it, it'd be better, and then maybe something about like that. So you can just see you can't really see it, but the red from about right there continues that way and that way. So this line that I have on the paper, that's a fairly good line, fairly good linear approximation. Now, I won't go over how to find the best possible line, because that's a topic of a class that comes after this one, but I promise you that there's legitimate methods to come up with a line which is the best possible line. So, and I told you the best possible line in the assignment. So, suppose we wanted to, compute, say, 1 over 0.73. Well, notably,
0.73 is in this interval, because that's half to 1. And if that's half, this is about that, so 0.73 is about right here. So what we want is that particular value.
Well, the way we're actually going to compute it, is we're going to come up with that linear approximation.
So if this is our linear approximation,
we're going to say that our guess, our first guess, is actually going to be the one that falls on this line. And because we're using that line as our first guess, did we overestimate or underestimate the true value? Over. We overestimated it, right? So now we're going to use a Newton iteration to get closer and closer to it. Okay, so the Newton iteration will get you there, and it's described in the homework assignment. So now, what this will do is this allows you to compute the reciprocal of any number between half and 1. And that seems kind of specific, right? using this Newton's method, you can compute the reciprocal of any number between half and 1. But it's sort of surprising to realize that that's enough to perform any division whatsoever. If you can compute the reciprocal of any number between half and 1. Because
2. Now suppose we wanted to perform the floating point division of, say, n over d.
So this would be to compute n over d, say, for example, 8 over 5. But we want to do it using only this method that we wrote on the previous page. Only that. Okay.
Well, here's the recursive definition of floating point division.
So in the first place, we're going to want to compute the reciprocal of d. That is to say, we want to compute 1 over d. Now, what must be true about d in order for us to use the information that we had on the previous page? What must be true about d? It's got to be real. So both n and d are real. If we want to compute the reciprocal of d using this information, then we can only do it in this box. So what must be true about d?
That is between 1 half and 1.
Yeah, it's got to be between half and 1. So conceivably, d could be anywhere. In particular, d could be negative. D could be negative. Okay, so the first thing that we're going to do is we need to make sure that d is on the right half of the line. So
the floating point division of n over d is, in the first place, defined as the floating point division of negative n over negative d when d is negative.
So why will that work? So why is that legitimate to do? Let's think about why this is reasonable.
Well, the reason why this is reasonable is that n over d, which is what we're trying to compute, but without using the division operator, that's the same as negative n over negative d, right?
Because the negatives would cancel. So whatever this answer is, whatever that answer is, it's got to be the same as that one.
But what that what this line allows us to do, it allows us to only consider the case when D is positive. Because if D is negative, then we just negate the numerator and the denominator. Okay. So in the next case, we could consider, well, what if, again, we can only compute reciprocals for D's between half and 1. What if D is positive, yet smaller than half? Like, what if we wanted to compute 1 over 0.27? Well, 0.27 is not in the interval that we know how to deal with. So how can we fix it?
Multiply it by 2.
Multiply what by 2?
Whole expression.
Okay, so I know what you mean, but you're not saying quite the right thing.
Okay. Multiply the denominator by 2.
Yeah?
Successively until it's in the interval that we can.
Okay, so that's almost right. Because
well, keeping a tab of how many times we've done it, maybe.
Okay, good. Right, so then this will be now the floating point division of 2n, 2d. Okay, when zero is less than d is less than half. So that is to say, when we have a positive d, but d is not big enough. Okay, now, why is, so we showed that this, whatever this is, has to be the same as that. Why does this have to be the same as this? Yeah?
Because you can divide up the greatest common denominator between the fractions.
Right. Because n over d, which is what we're looking for, that's got to be the same as 2n over 2d, which is to say the 2's would cancel. So if the denominator is not big enough, then multiply the numerator and the denominator by 2. That won't change the quotient. Okay, what's so this first case handles the case when the denominator is negative. This case handles when the denominator is positive but not big enough. What's another thing that we would need to handle?
D is too large.
Yeah.
It's larger than 1.
Yeah. So in this case, what will the arguments be? So this will be FP div of what?
1/2 n and 1/2 d.
Half n, half d. When the denominator is too big. Okay, so what this is saying, so why will this one work? So why is this the same as that, the same as that, and the same as that?
The halves will cancel.
The halves cancel. This is because n over d, that's what we're looking for. That's the same as half n divided by half d.
So does the range for n not matter?
It doesn't.
Okay.
It doesn't because once all of these cases are exhausted, that is to say, once the denominator has been flipped to the positive side, mm-hmm. and then shifted if it to the right if it was too small, and shifted to the left if it was too big. Now by the time all these cases are exhausted, now we have a denominator that is between half and one. So now we have a denominator between half and one. Which means that we can use this from the previous page. We've got a D that's somewhere in here. Which means that we can use this Newton iteration described in the exercise to compute the reciprocal of D. So then the answer is now that it's going to be N multiplied by the reciprocal reciprocal of D. So why should this work?
N over D, that's what we're looking for. And this is saying that, well, this is N multiplied by 1 over D, isn't it?
So what I'm telling you is that on this page, you know, we described a method to compute the reciprocal of any number between half and 1. And that's enough to compute the division of any two numbers, so long as the denominator is not 0, using this method. So all that these three cases in front do is they just make sure that the denominator is amenable to doing this iteration. That's all that these first three cases do. And then finally it does this. And it may be surprising to you, maybe not, to find out that this is more or less exactly what the machine is doing if you got out a microscope and looked at the little bitty circuit traces inside of it. It's incredible.
I have a question.
Yes?
On the third one?
This one?
Yeah, why does D not have an echo time? Does it just continuously?
Well, it's just the biggest. It's just a D can be as big as you want. Like say you wanted to compute 400 divided by a million. Well, that denominator, million, is too big. So you keep dividing it, the numerator and the denominator, by 2 over and over and over until the denominator is between half and 1. And if the denominator, you know, this is you know, my denominator's on the wrong side of the line. This one is, well, my denominator's too cold, right? And my denominator's too warm. And this is the one where, oh, my denominator is just right. Right? In the Goldilocks parlance. Okay, any question about this? Yes? Mm-hmm. And it's a good question to wonder if that's a fact, but I'm just going to state without proof that yes, it is in fact possible. Given any D whatsoever that's positive, you can repeatedly either multiply or divide by 2, and you will reach the interval half to 1. Other questions? Okay, it's a lovely exercise. So the next topic we'll talk about is, so there's a lot of topics that are sort of bread and butter, near and dear to all programmers. One of them is searching, and we've done a lot of problems where essentially it comes down to you're searching for something, like you're searching for the number that I hid, right? Which is the guess the number game, where you're bisecting to the true answer. And then there's other iterations on this, like finding the integer square root by bisecting. You did that. Okay, so then a counterpart to searching is called sorting. So now we're going to talk about sorting for a moment. Okay, so all that sorting means is that you take a finite list of elements, say a finite list of integers, and you want to put them into order, usually increasing order, but decreasing order could be the request of the day. So let x1, x2, xn be in the reals, say. And we want to sort these into increasing order. So specifically, we want, and we're going to do this by finding a permutation sigma such that x of sigma 1 is less or equal to x of sigma of 2 is less or equal to dot 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 is less or equal to x of sigma n. So that's sort of an abstract definition. It's really, really too abstract to get your hands, to wrap your hand head around the problem. So let's have an example. So for example, let's consider the numbers 3, 4, 1, 8, 9, 2, 3, 7, 0. So here's a nice list of numbers. Are these numbers in sorted order?
No.
No, right? So then we want them to be in increasing order. So does anyone have any suggestion about how we could go about doing that? So what do you think?
Kind of do a bubble sort.
A bubble sort?
Yeah, like check, is 3 less than 4? It is. Is 4 less than 1? It's not. So we move the 1 over.
Okay. So you're saying compare successive pairs and
yes.
Permute things. Okay, so I agree, and we're going to do something like that. But how would you do it if I said right now, for $10? Okay, I want you to do it.
Just
how would you do it?
Look at it.
Just look at it. Right? Yeah. So humans kind of have a difficult time describing exactly what it is that they do. Yeah.
A naive approach might be to find the minimum and then write it down, and then find the minimum of the remaining elements and write it down.
Okay. Okay, I like that. So a lot of humans would solve the problem exactly like that, which is to say, okay, I'm going to look at this, and I can see that the smallest one is 0. Okay, so the smallest one is 0, and then of what remains, what's the next smallest?
1.
And then of what remains?
2.
And then what? 3, but there's 2 3s, right? Okay. So a 3, and then now what?
3.
Another 3. And now what?
4,
7,
8,
9. So what I want you to sort of observe is that here was a 0, and it sort of moved. It moved over here. So this one went here. And then 1 was in the third position in the list, and it moved to here. And then 2 moved. And then 3 moved. And which 3? You know, now I have to decide if I'm going to continue drawing arrows, which 3 is that 3? Which one?
It's not 1 to 1.
Right. So it's not unique at any rate, right? So then I have to choose, did this 3 go there or did that 3 go there? So generally speaking, this is not something we're really going to be too worried about in this class because it's not really a computer science class. Generally speaking, when you have lists of things, this 3 came before that 3. So if I call this the red 3 and this one the green 3, because in the list the red 3 came before the green 3, in the output generally you want the red 3 to also come before the green 3. So whatever order they happen to be in this list, you want them to be in the same order in this list. That's generally a desirable property. So I'll say that this 3 went here, and this one here. To there. 7. Okay, so these arrows constitute a permutation, which is to say that when I wrote this sigma of 1, sigma of 2, sigma of 3, what that means for this particular drawing, as it happened, the permutation sigma, which performs this, what is supposing that this is position 1, and position 2, and position 3, and position 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. What is sigma of 1? Which is to say, to where did position 1 go?
4.
To 4, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. So sigma of 1 is 4. Similarly, sigma of 2 is what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Sigma of 3 is 2. Sigma of 4, so there's that one, so that went to 8. Sigma of 5, so 9 went to 9. That's kind of funny. Sigma of 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 went to 3. Seven went to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 8 went to 7. And 9 went to 1.
Interesting. So sort of fundamentally what sorting is, in a sense, is you're trying to find the permutation, sigma, which tells you where to put the arrows. So this process that we did out loud, that's called sorting by selection, okay, or selection sort. Because what you're doing is you're, you know, looking at it and saying, oh, that one's the smallest, so it goes first, and then you continue looking and say, oh, that's the next smallest, so it goes next, etc., until the end. Okay. Now, there's a little bit of a problem with that method. Okay, it works fine. It worked fine here. But suppose, say, that I wrote down, instead of writing down 9 numbers, suppose I wrote down 9 million numbers. And you know, I just wrote them all down the whiteboard there. Okay, and then let's imagine you're going to scan through 9 million numbers and say, oh, I found the smallest one, and then write it down. And then start back at the beginning. Say, okay, now I'm going to scan. I'm going to cross that one off. I'm going to start back at the beginning and scan all the way until I find the smallest one. Okay, that's the next smallest one. Write it down, cross it off the list. Okay, so on a list,
that has 9 million numbers, you'd have to scan 9 million times.
Wouldn't you do it 9 million squared, approximately?
Well, you'd have to scan the list 9 million times, and because that's how many scans you'd do, and each scan, you're checking approximately 9 million things. So you're doing about 9 million squared things. That's a lot of things to do. It's a lot. So, you know, you might think, are there better ways to go about sorting? And the answer is yes, there's far better ways to go about sorting. So when we were playing the guess the number game, and suppose it came to a place where I said something like, okay, I'm thinking of a number between 1,000 and 2,000. Okay, and it's an integer. Then here's one strategy. I could say, well, is it 1,000? And then you say, no. I say, okay. Is it 1,001? No. Okay. Is it 1,002? No. Right? And then so that's not a very clever strategy, but it will work, right? Because I just iterate through all the possibilities one at a time, and that will surely work, but it's going to take a while. What was the far better strategy that we used?
Either powers of two or bisecting.
Yeah, by bisecting. By saying that, okay, well, let's, if you say your number is between 1,000 and 2,000, I'm going to guess 1,500 and see how you respond. Now, if I get super lucky and you say, ah, oh, you got it, then okay, finished. But otherwise, you're going to tell me that my guess is too big or too small. And that's pretty good, because if you tell me, in either case, you tell me that my guess is too big or too small, I've eliminated half of the possibilities. Right? So half of them are gone. So if I say 1,500 is my guess and you say that's too small, I've eliminated 500 possibilities. Whereas when I say, if you say I'm thinking of a number between 1,000 and 2,000 and I just start guessing with 1,000 and you say no, or whatever you say, I've only eliminated one. And then I guess 1,001, I've only eliminated one. And then I guess 1,002, I've only eliminated one. So it's far better to eliminate as many as you can. So we're going to come up with a similar strategy for sorting to make our lives work as good as possible and to make the sorting procedure work as good as possible. Okay. So, any question about this idea? Okay. So, we need just a little bit of terminology. Technical bits. So first, a sequence x1, x2, dot dot dot, xn is said to be sorted when x I minus 1 is less or equal to xi for all I equal to 2, 3, n, which is to say you take all consecutive elements of the sequence and you perform the less or equal operation on them. You compare. If for every consecutive pair that they're in the right order, then the whole list is in the right order. Okay, which is to say no two consecutive numbers are out of order. Okay, so let's think about this for a moment, because this has some implications that are a little bit confusing until you think about it. Okay, so how about a list of three numbers? Is it conceivable that a list of three numbers could be unsorted?
Yes.
Yeah. So can you give me an example of a list of three numbers that's and this list is not sorted?
1, 3, 2.
1, 3, 2. Okay, can we all agree? 1, 3, 2 is not sorted. Okay. Can you give me a list of three numbers that is sorted?
1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3. Okay, or 1, 1, 1. For example. Okay. How about a list of two numbers? Is it conceivable that a list of two numbers could be unsorted?
Sure.
Yeah, right? So how about pi, 0? Not sorted. And it's also conceivable that a list of two numbers could, in fact, be sorted, like, say, 9, 10. Okay. How about a list of one number? No, it's got to be sorted. But you got to think about it now. Why should it be the case that every list of one that every sequence that contains just every finite sequence that contains just one number? Why should it be that sequence is sorted?
Because in order for it not to be, there has to be two consecutive numbers.
Right. So the logical position is to say, well, it's vacuously sorted because there's nothing to check. Right?
By that definition.
By the definition, right? Which is to say that consider this a sequence that has just one number in it. Say it's just got the number 4 in it. Now take the set of all pairs, of all consecutive pairs. Well, tell me about the set of all consecutive pairs of the sequence which contains just 4. The set of consecutive pairs is empty. Right? So every proposition over the elements of the empty set is automatically true. So for example, are you aware that UTD has won every national football championship we've ever participated in? Yeah, it's pretty incredible, huh? So in the first place, is that a true statement?
Yes.
It is. It is true. We've won every one of them that we've ever participated in. Now, why is that statement true?
Because we've never participated in.
Yeah, because the set of all national championship games that we've ever participated in is empty. It's also true that every national championship game that we've ever participated in, we've lost. It's also true that every national championship game we've ever participated in has been a purple giraffe. All of those things are true. So, as a result, sequences which contain zero or one elements are sorted vacuously. Okay. So now we're going to use this to come up with a procedure which will sort a list, sort a sequence, and it'll do it quite fast, quite fast. I guess let's do the trivial one first. So this will be bubble sort. You've got to do sort of a dumb one before you do a clever one. So bubble sort has the following procedure. So one, you from 2 to n, you compare consecutive elements, consecutive. Man, I'm having trouble with that. I'm not sure about that. Consecutive?
I think it's a C instead of a Q.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah.
I believe you. I mean, I just...
I think that's it.
I don't know.
I don't know either. I'm looking at too much.
Is it a C? Okay. You know what I mean. Okay. Compare consecutive elements. Swap the consecutive elements if they're out of place. So if they're out of order. Order. And then 3, supposing, so if you make it to the end of the list, to the end of the sequence without a swap, then what?
It's sorted.
Then it's sorted. Otherwise, it may not be sorted. So you need to go back to 1. Which is to say, we're just going to iterate over the list, and we're going to compare consecutive elements. If they're out of order, swap them into the right order, and just go down the list over and over and over again until finally you make it through the list and you didn't have to do any swaps. Okay. So let's see an example of doing this.
If you started from the end and went to the beginning, would that take care of having to run through it again?
There's a lot of ways to do it.
Okay.
There's so many ways to do it, but okay. This is just one way. Cool. So for example, let's bubble sort, say, MATLAB. Into alphabetical order, which is to say we're going to compare consecutive elements. Okay, so which ones are we comparing first?
M and A,
right? So we're going to compare M and A. And how about those? Are they in the right order?
No.
They're not. So what are we going to do?
Swap
them. Okay, so then A, M, T, L, A, B. So we swapped them. So now what are we going to compare?
M and T.
M and T, right? I'm going to compare those. So how about those? Are they in the right order?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes. Yes, T comes after M. Yes. Okay. So on this one, I'll mark this one because we did a swap. So we did a swap. This one, we didn't swap it, so I'll leave that one unmarked. So A, M, T, L, A, B. So now we're comparing T and L. Are they in the right order?
No.
They're not. So we'll swap them, A, M, L, T, A, B. So we swapped on that step, so I'll mark it. Okay, now we're comparing T and A. not in the right order. So they'll need to be swapped. AMLATB. Now we're comparing T and B. They're not in the right order, so they need to be swapped. So A, M, L, A, B, T. Any question about that? So now, you can sort of see how we made it through the list in one scan. So that's one scan. Now, in that scan, did we perform any swaps? Yeah, we performed four of them. So that means that now we go back to the beginning and start over. Okay. We'll compare A and M. Are they in the right order?
Yes.
Yes. So A, M, L, A, B, T. Okay. How about M and L? Are they in the right order?
No.
No. So they're going to need to be swapped. A, L, M, A, B, T. Now we're comparing M and A. Not in the right order. So they'll be swapped. A, L, A, M, B, T. Now we're comparing M and B. Those are not in the right order. So they'll be swapped. B, M, T. Okay. And then M and T, those are in the right order. So you can see that because of the way, you know, you get these diagonals lining up. Visually, you can see, we've done a second scan. Did we have to perform any swaps in that second scan?
Yes.
Yes. So we go back to the beginning. And I'd like to point out, isn't this boring? Of course it is. It's terribly boring. This is why we made machines. So A and L. Are they in the right order?
Yes.
Yes. L and A.
No.
Not in the right order. Well, you can see we're making progress, right? Because already we've got the A's have made it to the front, and the T made it to the end. So we're getting there. So LB.
Out of order.
So now it'll be A, A, B, L, M, T. L and M are in the right order now. Yes, they're in the right order. And then A, A, B, L, M, T. Are these in the right order?
Yes.
They are. So here's the third scan. Was anything out of order?
Yes.
Yes. Which means that we'll have to scan again. Okay, so now, you have to scan again. That's the way the program has to be written, but can you see now that they're actually in order? So we would do one more scan, and we'd go through and say, no swaps were performed, so we did it. So I'll write plus one more scan. So in principle, this would surely work. Any question about this? So this constitutes a method to figure out how to sort something, but it is terribly slow. You should never ever do this kind of thing. Okay. Now, can someone give us a better method? Let's think about it. What if we had a stack of, say, books? You know, just like a dump truck full of books. And the point was that we wanted to, say, alphabetize them by author. What do you think?
Okay, I have an idea, but it's maybe best for numbers, although we can maybe translate for letters too. So what if we took the average of the list, and then if it was above the average, we put it in one pile, and if it was lower than the average, we put it in another pile. And then we find the averages of those piles, and we keep splitting it by the average.
Okay, I like it. I like it. You could say, if these were numbers, if there were numbers, then you could iterate over the whole list, like check them all out. You could check every one and then compute the average, the mean, or the median, or something. Probably average, because median is too complicated to compute. So we'll compute the average. And then, so we have the average in our head, right? And then now we make two big piles and say, okay, one pile is going to be all the numbers that are less than the average, and the other pile is going to be all the numbers that are more than the average. I like that. Okay. But that doesn't get it sorted.
In the bookcase, at the very end, there might be two
tweaks. Well, so what I mean is, all that I'm saying, I agree with tweaks at the end, but what I'm saying is that supposing we do that, now we just have two piles.
Well, we do it iteratively.
Ah, so you're saying now do it again for each pile, right? So now in the smaller pile, now you iterate just over the smaller pile, compute the average, and now you split that pile into two piles. Okay. Then now you take any one of the piles, compute the average, split it into two. And notice that you can only split a list of elements into two so many times, right? Eventually, when you split it into two, the size of a pile is going to be one or zero. And such sequences are sorted by definition. Right? Okay, that's interesting. Now, there's a slight problem, because as you said, as you disclaimed at the beginning, it works for numbers.
We could maybe assign the letters, you know, a number. I guess in the book exactly you said, okay, well, the average is maybe, L? I don't know. And so A through L or M.
Okay. Yeah, we could say A is 1, B is 2, and Z is 26, and then average them like that. Yeah, okay. So what if we were talking about objects that simply were not amenable to arithmetic in this way? We were talking about objects that where you can't say, all you can say is that either they're in the right order or they need to be swapped, but you have no concept of how big one is relative to the other. Yes?
Well, then you could just take like any element in the list and use that as the dividing point.
Okay, just take a random book, a random thing, and then go through the whole list and say, okay, I'm holding this one, this is my favorite one, and now I'm going to go through the whole list, and everything that's less than, that's the less than pile, and everything that's not less than is in the other pile. So now I'm splitting it with just this one book. I just go over to the pile, grab whatever book suits my fancy, and then compare every book and make two piles. Okay? Then now we have two piles and we can do this over again, right? So then now we go to one of the other piles, grab a random book, split it into piles, saying, okay, these are all the books that were less, these are all the books that were not less, and then continue. Interesting. So that would work. That would work. So that procedure that we just said, you take more or less a random element and then use this one element to break the list into two pieces, that actually has a name. That procedure is by now decades old. Who knows its name? Does anyone happen to know it? It's the most famous, probably the most famous sorting procedure that there is. No? It's called quick sort. Quick sort. Okay.
What is the how many operations does it need to perform to get the end to it?
Well,
right.
Well, I'm trying to avoid too much technical discussion because it's not there. But so the worst possibility for that procedure. Notice that I said I just go over and I pick a random book. So here's the worst possible case, is that if every time I pick a random book, I pick the smallest book, or if I pick the biggest book. Yeah. If I always pick an endpoint. Then that means you're going to have to pick in different books, and then one of the piles is always empty, so that it doesn't do anything except it doesn't break the problem down very quickly. Now, if you get super lucky and you always pick the book that happens to be right in the middle, so that the less than pile is the same size as the greater than pile, then that's bisecting. And you can only bisect a number so many times, right? So for example, you can only bisect 1,000 about 10 times. So if we had 1,000 books and we did this, we picked a random book and it happened to be the middle book every time, we'd only have to perform 10 splittings. Okay, but if every time I picked the smallest book by some cosmic bad luck, then we'd have to perform 1,000 splittings. Okay? So it's kind of complicated to deal with quicksort exactly. But I'm trying to avoid the issue. Okay, so remark. Quicksort. So suppose that we're given a list of numbers, a sequence of numbers, x1, x2, dot dot dot, xn. Then we can quicksort the list in the following procedure. Okay, so then 1. Choose a random element, a random one of these. So I'll say, you know, maybe it's xj. So it'd be just like going to the pile of books and saying, I like the green one, and then just picking that one up. Okay, then 2. So the name for this, in case you get real excited and go start looking up sorting procedures and things like this, this XJ is called the pivot. Now we're going to make 2 sublists. We'll make a list that we'll call L, which is the set of all X's, so XI1, XI2, up to XIM, and these are all of the X's that are less than or equal to XJ. Such that x I l is less or equal to x j. And r is the list of all the others. So which is to say that all of these, all of the elements in this list are either less or equal to xj or not. L is the, is the, is the set of all of them that are less or equal, and R is a set of all of them that aren't. Okay, now 3. Recurse into L and R and concatenate the list when you get done. Okay, so let's have an example. So MATLAB is not quite long enough of a word to have something interesting. So maybe what's a longer word? Oh man, that's a lot. how about
neurologist?
Okay. Is that what you said?
No, not quite.
What did you say?
Meteorologist.
Meteorologist. Okay, even better. Okay. Let's see if I can even spell that. Okay. I need to write them further out, more spaced out. What am I doing? I just said I need to write them more spaced out. Meteorologist. Okay. So what we need to do is we need to first randomly select an element, right? That is to say, I need to go up to the pile and select one. Okay, so I'm going to randomly select the first one, randomly. So I'm going to select this one to pivot against. And now what we're going to do is we're going to make two lists. We're going to make two lists. And we're going to take all of the things less or equal to M and put them in the first list, and all of the things that are not less or equal in the other list. Okay. So in the first place, is M less or equal to M?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so then that one goes here. So M. Is E less or equal?
Yes.
Is T less or equal?
No.
No. So it goes over here. Ish. Somewhere over here. How about E?
Yes.
Yes. How about O?
No.
No. So it goes over here. How about R?
No.
No. How about another O? How about, what's next? L.
Yes.
Yeah. How about even another O?
No.
Okay. G?
Yes.
Yes. And then I?
Yes.
Yes. And then S? No. And then T. So this list, this is the L list, the things that were less or equal, and the R list. Interesting. So we split it into these two. Now what are we going to do?
Take a random one for each pile.
Yeah, now we have two piles, and we're going to do the same thing that we did before. Now, in this pile, let's choose a random one. So, which one do you want me to pick?
E.
E? Okay, which E?
The second one,
okay. So, for just this one now, we're ignoring this one. For just this one now, we're gonna check the less or equal. So, in the first place, how about M?
No.
No, so it goes over here, right? So, M. How about E?
Yes.
Yes, E is less or equal to E. How about the next E? Yes. How about L? No. How about G? M, E, C, D, E, F. So G, it goes over this one, and then I goes in this one. So notice that we actually did pretty good with this one, right? So that looks to my eye a pretty good split down the middle. That's a split, but it's not quite in the middle. Okay, but that's okay. So then, so now we have these two lists. So this one was broken into these two, so now we need to do this one. Okay, so what random element do you want to pick?
The third O.
The third O. All right. Okay, so then now we're going to make two lists. So where does T go?
Greater than.
On the other side, right? Okay, how about O? On the left. How about R?
Right side.
On the right. How about O?
Left.
On the left. How about O?
Left.
How about S?
Right.
Right. And how about the T?
Right.
On the right. Okay, so is there any question about getting to this? So what we've done now, is we took this one list and we split it into two lists. And then we took this list and we split it into two lists. And this one into two. Okay, so now what? So it's not quite sorted yet in the first place.
Do we have to split E and G?
Mm-hmm. We gotta split it, so which one do you want to randomly choose?
The first one.
It sounds silly for me to say which one of these do you want to randomly choose, but you've got to understand that it's going to be perfectly fine to MATLAB.
Yeah.
MATLAB's not going to care. Okay, so which one do you want to randomly choose?
The first one.
Okay. So is E less or equal to E?
Yes.
It is. Is E less or equal to E?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So then notice that the other one is empty. Okay. So that one is empty. So I'll just draw that to denote that it's empty. Now, in this one, which one do you want to randomly select?
L.
Okay. So then this one splits then. So if we choose L, then M is greater than, L is less or equal to L, G is less or equal, and I is less or equal. So this split like that and that, this split like that and like that. Okay, I'll choose the last O because why not? Okay, so then O, 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 and then blank, empty, right? So someone tell me about these blanks. What does that signify when you perform a split and you get
it? Sorted.
Yeah.
That pile.
Yeah, this one is sorted, right?
Yeah.
So that's done. Okay. So now, finally, how about, which one do you want to randomly select here?
S.
S. Okay. So then, S, Q, or S, T, R, S. Okay, so R, S, and then T, T. So now here's something that I forgot to mention. This is important. Part of the important part is, well, we're basically out of time now. So I'll have to write up the details at the end. So have we done it yet? Not quite, right? So then these are in order. Those are in order. Those are in order. Those are in order. That one by itself is in order. This is the last one. It's not in order. Okay, so we'll have to describe the base case in the written homework. But this is quicksort. Okay, so notably, how many splits did we have to make? So we did 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then for this one we'd have to do it probably once more. So we had to make about 8 splits. And notice, as far as writing is concerned, how much more rapidly this is proceeding than this one. Proceeds far more rapidly. And what's better is that if you have multiple people, if we were all in here and someone dumped a million books, then we could do the procedure quite rapidly by saying, okay, to start, I'm going to pick a book, and now we'll start making piles. Okay, then once there's 2 piles, then we can split the people and say, okay, all of you come with me, and all of you go with the other person, and then now we continue, right? And the procedure can go with 2 captains. Okay, very good. I'll see you on Thursday.